I recall watching YouTubers playing the alpha and betas of this game, but I never seen them play the full release. So I randomly saw this game when I got a month subscription for PS Plus. So I figured I might as well try it out. This game, some reason, it's for some reason really scared me. Still kind of scares me. I don't know why, but it's very eerie. It's just the thought of breaking into someone's house, being caught is super scary for me. I don't really know why. I don't know the story of the game. It's all weird and not really straightforward. But what I got from this is that you're a nameless character that's moved into a new neighborhood. You're being nosy as hell, trying to reach your neighbor's basement and reveal his dark secrets. The game is a medium for difficulty. The puzzles are a little complex because there's like so much going on. The house is humongous, and there's a ridiculous amount of random shit you gotta do for the plat. The game's a 4 out of 10 for me. Despite my unnervedness, the game was very glitchy and buggy, and it just wasn't the best game for me, honestly. I saw the game was on sale for $5, and I said screw it. I knew a guy who makes guides on Lego games, so might as well. The story is just the first four Harry Potter movies, but it's Lego, so there's nothing new. I honestly did not like this game at all, and it's not it's like it's one of the first Lego games where there's no voice lines, so it's just hums and noises. The game is really easy to platinum because it's a Lego game, the doy. But ranking this based off the other Lego games, it's a 3 out of 10 for me. It's the worst one I've played, but I only played like 6 Lego games, so I'm not a credible judge. But it is definitely the worst one out of all of them, in my opinion, out of all the ones I've played. If I sound different, it's because I got a new headset, so that's why. But like I said when I was talking about Modern Warfare 1 Remastered in the last video, my first Call of Duty was Black Ops 2, and I still never played a COD before that, besides the remasters of 1 and 2, Modern Warfare 1 and 2. This game was surprisingly like really good though. I really loved the story, I sadly saw the big reveal before the meme now, the last one loose end reveal. I knew a little bit about No Russian, but when I played that, holy shit, that completely caught me off guard, honestly. This game looked beautiful though. The White House missions where it's on fire and attacked. Oh man, it looks so amazing. Like color wise, I'm not an anti-American. But about the story. The story of the game takes place 5 years after the first game, where the protagonist that you played is now a captain, Mr. Soap. He sends a rookie in his squad, who is an American, to get into a Russian terrorist inner circle, but they leave your recruit behind on a mission on Russian soil, starting a new Cold War. The Platinum is hard for difficulty. You gotta beat the game on veteran difficulty, which is not that hard, honestly. The main kick in the ass is the practice range. You gotta do the practice range in, I believe, 17 seconds. You gotta have a perfect run, 100, 105% accuracy, never stop running, hit all enemy targets and don't hit any friendly targets. It's a real pain in the ass, but it's possible. 8 out of 10 game, honestly. The story is phenomenal and the game looks beautiful. I watched The Incredibles obsessively as a kid. It's one of the best superhero movies of all time. It's my favorite Pixar movie of all time. I still love the movie today. Like, honestly. If you haven't seen it yet, treat yourself and watch the first one. Not the second one, though. The game is just the two movies but Lego, so there's no new story. This game came out around the time where I think they asked the voice actors to come to the studio and record new lines. For the game, because I don't recall that much dialogue in the movies. The game is easy to platinum because it's a Lego game, but I really like the way the collectibles were in this game. They're like some reason like loot box type things. I don't know why. There's some builds that are of other Pixar movies, and that was really cool in other franchises. That was super dope. 8 out of 10 game compared to the other Lego games. I really liked it. This game came out with the other Harry Potter game, years 1 through 4. The story is just the last four Harry Potter movies, so nothing new. I really didn't like this game also. Honestly, everything I said about years 1 through 4 is the same here. I took a tiny break in between the Uncharted games. I don't really know why. Because all three came out with the Nathan Drake collection. I forgot how much I enjoyed the series when I was playing number 3. To the point where I gunned it for number 4 when I was done. I think I like this game as much as number 2. It's like a tie really because both games are fantastic. This game takes place to 2 years after the last game. And Nate Sully and Chloe, and a new addition to the team, Charlie Cutter, are looking for the Rama of the Pillars in the Rubalcali Desert. As usual, they're racing against an evil organization to the treasure that's in the city to make sure that they don't abuse its power. The Platinum is the same as the last three. Beat the game on the hardest difficulty. There's a couple strats that can make it easier. You gotta grab all the collectibles, so you gotta kill a certain amount of enemies with certain weapons, and speedrun some chapters. Not every platinum's the same. All three platinums, I did the exact same: beat the story, and beat on crushing, get all the collectibles, get the rest of the cleanup, and then speedrun the trophies. Did all three the exact same. I think the boss is a tiny bit harder on crushing difficulty than number 2. Because you can't really tell the progress you're making. I don't really remember you visibly seeing how much progress you made against him. This game is really good though. I recommend playing the trilogy. 9 out of 10 game. I immediately played the fourth Uncharted game right after the third. I absolutely love this game. Like, holy shit, it is so good. It's my favorite one by far. The game is so well polished, the multiple areas that you explore, and the addition of Sam, that's played by Troy Baker. Chef's kiss. Nate and Elena's relationship is like one of my favorites in all of gaming. Like, besides like Deacon and Sarah and Days Gone. The story takes place 3 years after the last game, where Nate and Elena are finally married and are trying to live a normal life. But Nate's brother Sam appears and asks Nate to help him find the treasure of Henry Avery. The hunt leads to the long-lost pirate utopia called Libertalia. You go on a wild goose chase, like around the world to find this treasure, from Madagascar, Spain, Scotland, a couple islands in the ocean, but all around the world. The platinum is significantly easier than the last three, because this time around, you could use cheats on crushing, like infinite ammo. Like, I confess that I beat Crushing with the cheats, but I do eventually want to play the game without them, without the cheats. You also got to speedrun this game in under 6 hours, but once you, like, beat it on your first playthrough and Crushing, you'll handle it. It's not that bad. You got to get all the collectibles also. Instead of getting kills with certain weapons, there's a bunch of cool miscellaneous trophies that are found throughout the world. But sadly, there's some online trophies for the PS4 version, so you gotta like deal with that. The game is a 10 out of 10 in my opinion, though. It is a perfect. It's my favorite game of the Uncharted series by far. I think it's the best. I understand that people think the second one is the best too. I absolutely love this damn franchise, and if you haven't played it yet, please do. Dead by Daylight was free with PS Plus for a week in 2018, and me and my current friend group, we tried it out, and we enjoyed it. I don't know if it ever became free again, because I for some reason still have access to it, and it still counts as a PS Plus game. I have over 1,000 hours on this game, and it's a PS Plus game. I have a love-hate relationship with this game. I'm hardcore into it for a month or two, and then I'm burned out of it for a month or two, rinse and repeat. I'm currently in the hate part of the cycle right now, where I'm not playing it, but I know that'll change. Dead by Daylight is a game where it's a 4v1 PvP, where you can play as survivors, where you must repair 5 generators around the map to power the exit gates, open them, and then escape. Or you can play as the killer, where you're supposed to stop survivors by escaping, by hooking them on meat hooks, sacrificing them, kicking generators, etc. I got the PS4 Platinum over time. I never fully went for it. The Platinum is pretty hard, but I enjoy it. You gotta escape as all base game survivors with their unique perks. As all the base game killers, you gotta kill all 4 survivors with their 3 unique perks. And there's also 2 trophies that you gotta earn with each killer that you gotta use their specific powers, which I thought was pretty neat. The only grindy trophy is to sacrifice 500 survivors, which that will most likely be the biggest chunk for you. The game is a 5 out of 10 for me. I really love it. I really like playing it. But since it's a PvP game, the meta constantly changes, and people just play the more overpowered killers and the more overpowered perks. I never heard of the Hitman games before, but I saw that the first game was free in summer 2019. I figured might as well give it a shot. I thought it was okay, but then I retried it 1 year later, immediately got hooked into the world and the sandbox element sets in the game. I bought the most expensive version of Hitman 2 afterwards and got more addicted, to the point where I was burned out. I then bought the most expensive version of Hitman 3 when that came out. And every now and then I go back and try it out. I like to try out Freelancer. It's actually pretty fun and pretty unique. I'm going to talk about the story of Hitman 3, not the past two games. But if you want to see the full story for all three games, I livestreamed every single mission on all three. In this game, you're playing as the ultimate assassin named Agent 47. After the Constant has escaped your custody, they're trying to look and kill the last three partners of Providence that has ties with the Constant. The Platinum is pretty easy. You gotta do certain mission stories per map and reach the mastery level for every map, but it's not as bad as it seems. You just gotta do a bunch of challenges, which there's plenty of guides for. I love the Hitman games though. There's so many sandbox elements and so many different ways you can assassinate your targets. It's a 9 out of 10 game. It's pretty good, but it's not getting that updated. I never heard of this game before, besides it having its own bike skin on Days Gone. So I tried it in early 2021, and it's a meh. It's very beautiful and colorful, but the story is okay, I guess. Speaking of which, though, the story. The story is about a boy who gets harassed and bullied by a group of kids in a very nasty, polluted town. It's like the one in that one episode of Avatar: The Last Airbender, the Painted Lady. In season 3. But he gets a magical paintbrush that brings drawings and creatures to life that have their own abilities, and they help you bring back to bring back life to this dead city. My main problem I had with this game is the story, because you save the bullies from the dangers of the city as like things get heated up. And then once you save them, they become your friends. Just out of nowhere. It's like there's no arc. They're still dicks to each other. They're just now friends with you. It's like they never had a redemption arc at all, which I don't like. But yeah, the story's okay. I don't think it's the best, but it's not the worst, I guess. The Platinum is very, very easy. You just gotta beat the game, grab all the collectibles, which are all accessible after the story, and just do certain stuff with your paintbrush. It's very easy. I recommend it for an easy platinum. 6 out of 10. Thank you. game became free with PS Plus in early 2021, and it seemed like it was a fun thing to play with my friend Kirsten Krauss, who I also want to thank you for helping me get the footage, because you can only play this game with someone online. The game's an easy platinum, honestly, and it has a nice mix of eeriness in it. The story of the game is that two explorers come across an abandoned castle, and I think the Arctic, and they must work together to solve puzzles to get out. The games are very easy to platinum. The hardest trophies are to beat every puzzle without failing once, and to beat the entire game from start to finish without dying. If you have the game from with PS Plus, I recommend grabbing someone and getting that easy platinum. I had to get gameplay in New Game Plus because there's only one save slot on this game, and I'm not going to delete it for a 3-minute clip. But nevertheless, this game became free with PS Plus to help hype up the release of Rift Apart, and I figured might as well see what the newest Ratchet & Clank game is about. It was pretty good. Now that I planned on the very first two games, they never really miss with like their games with the Ratchet & Clank series. And I prefer the first two games way more than this. This one's still pretty good. The story of this one is that there's a Lombax named Ratchet who's trying to recruit for the Galactic Space Rangers, but gets denied. And there's a defective warbot named Clank crash lands on Ratchet's planet with information about someone trying to take over the galaxy. So they team up to find the Galactic Space Rangers and stop the enemies. The game is pretty easy to platinum, to be honest. You just gotta get all the miscellaneous trophies, which you could do after beating the game. Beat the game in challenge mode. It's just New Game Plus, but the game's a tiny bit harder. And I recommend trying this game out though, even if you're not interested in plats. The Ratchet and Clank games are always fun to play. They're always the best movements. 8 out of 10 in my opinion. I recommend trying it out. I never heard of this game before, never seen anybody play or talk about it, but once it became free with PS Plus, I did some research, and it actually seemed like a lot of fun. I actually enjoy playing this game now, and its sequel, and playing them kinda helps me become less scared of stuff. The music in this game is just absolutely bumping, and the environments are just crazy, like, they're so unique. This game is also a survival game, which I very much like. But the story of it is that this game is in this game, your spaceship crash lands on an alien planet that is like 95% water. And you must find resources to build a habitat, submarines for your way around, and a way off of the planet. The further down you go, the more dangerous it gets, and the darker it gets, and the bigger the fish get. This game is pretty damn scary, but it's phenomenal. There's like a cult following for this game because it's so damn good. The creatures on this planet are also so unique and cool. Never seen anything like it. And the environments and the biomes are just nuts. When I got the platinum, I did it the cheating way, where you use cheat codes. So I got it pretty fast. But I completed the game multiple times since then, like good amount of times afterwards. So, you know, I'm just gonna just say that. The platinum is pretty easy though, based off of like me platinuming it again. You just gotta beat the game and gotta do a couple extra regions and pick up a couple collectibles. You can get lost pretty easily because the map is huge, but there's plenty of guides by Chemical Apes for the game. It's a 10 out of 10 game for me. I beat the first mission in 2017, but then I just don't know why I just didn't go back to it. And in 2018, I beat the rest of the story. Again, I don't know why. I just didn't platinum it until 2.5 years later. Just, the game, though, was just the first two Avengers movies by LEGO. So Avengers 2012 and Avengers Age of Ultron 2015. So there's nothing new with the story, just LEGO. The game is also pretty easy to platinum because it's a Lego game. But I enjoyed platinuming it. You know, I like the Marvel Cinematic Universe, so, you know, it was fun to play platinum another Lego Marvel game. But I still like Lego Marvel Super Heroes, Lego Jurassic World, and Lego Incredibles way more. When I saw this trailer, I fell in love with the game. I recommended it to so many friends and was counting down the days for it to release. This game is so good. It's a masterpiece. This game has so many different puzzles and unique ways to solve them. The world of it is so beautiful and fantastic and unique. The characters are all lovable. There's so many funny and emotional moments for this game. And there's so many unique abilities that the characters get to solve the puzzles. I played and platinumed this game with Kirsten Kraus, and we decided not to touch the PS5 version until we both got a PS5 to play it, to platinum it again together. We were so damn happy when it won Game of the Year, where we were texting each other during the Game Awards, and she immediately texted me in excitement that it won. Also, I want to thanks Kirsten for playing the game with me to help me get footage. We kept playing after I got a good amount of footage because we just both love this game so much. The story of the game, though, is that there's a couple who's divorcing, and they have a daughter. Sadly, the daughter gets sad. She runs off. And while she's talking to her dolls and crying, she accidentally casts a spell on her parents and transfers them into the dolls. And now they're supposed to go on an epic adventure around their house by solving puzzles and reunite their relationship and become together again. This platinum is pretty easy. You just gotta beat the game and find all the hidden mini games. And there's a couple miscellaneous trophies, which every single trophy in this game is unique. Every single trophy in this game you want, or like you not no you don't want, but like every just they're all unique in their own special ways. You remember every single trophy you get. You remember every single mini game. You remember every single ability. This game will stick with you because it is that damn good. Like, I'm rambling right now. I don't care if I make this section for It Takes Two longer, because because I love this game this much where I will talk about this game for 10 minutes if I really, really want to. But I'm not going to. I'm going to go back to the script. Well, it says, I absolutely love this game. I can't wait to see what the developers make next. Because the devs made A Way Out. And I never played it, but I heard it was fucking fantastic also. And yeah, this game won Game of the Year. It beat Ratchet and Clank and Deathloop and Psychonauts 2. And fucking Metroid. It beat all of those games because it was that damn good. It's crazy. This game is a 20 out of 10 for me. It's my favorite game I released in 2021, without a doubt. It's just so good, man. I can't keep saying that enough. I can't keep praising this game enough. It is so good. Please, please find someone, anyone, and play the game. Hell, I'll play it with you. I love this game so much, I'll play it with anyone. This game is a fucking masterpiece. And please treat yourself and play it. I recorded the gameplay in this in New Game Plus because this game is really damn long. But I saw that the most expensive digital version of this game was massively on sale, like 80% off. I figured I might as well try it out since it takes place during the Greek/Spartan times. And I love this game. I enjoyed every single moment playing platinuming it and playing its DLC. This game is a really long platinum though, like 100 hours to 120. I also know that this game's not very liked amongst the AC community, because it has RPG elements that get rid of its stealth elements more, even though it does still have stealth. But I actually only play two Assassin's Creed games, Odyssey and Black Flag, and I love Black Flag way more. But I did like the RPG elements of this game, but it did seem a little bit tedious at times. But I also liked the assassination part of it, I missed that. The map is kind of big though, but they have a ship. That helps you get across it. The ship battles are actually pretty fun, but nowhere as near as the ones in Black Flag. There's also heaps of side quests and world quests that you can do. There's like basically infinite amounts of them, so you can always be busy. The story though follows Cassandra, a mercenary or mystios in their terms, that has been separated from her family and ends up on a small island. She then finds out that her family is alive, and she seeks out to look for him and take out the cult that separated them in the first place. The platinum is pretty easy. There's no difficulty related trophies or miserable trophies, so you can get the rest of the trophies after the story. But this game is just really damn long. But I enjoyed it. No, I would definitely play it again if it wasn't so long. But yeah, just 8 out of 10 game if you have the patience to fully beat and platinum the game. I don't know why I even played this game. It's just a pick-your-own-adventure of three men going on a wild adventure across the sea. You just gotta do every choice, which will take you give or take 2 hours. Recommend it for easy platinum. It's honestly just, it's not fun at all. 2 out of 10. this was my final platinum on the PS4. I loved the first game so much that I couldn't wait to play the sequel. I played this game when it first came out, and I loved it just as much as the first game. But this game is nowhere near as good as the first game. But it did have some significant changes in some aspects, and they were so good that they put them in the first game, in the original Subnautica. This game is essentially just a DLC for the first game, though. Like Miles Morales to Marvel's Spider-Man 2018. New area, new creatures, but the game and the map is way smaller. And the story is really short. Like a fourth of the last one's story. Speaking of which, the story of this game takes place 2 years after the first one. The person we played finally goes back to the station that the company he worked for told them how to plan it. They went to the Arctic area of it to go excavating and mining. And now we follow Sam, a scientist that goes onto the now abandoned planet to find out more information about the death of her sister that happened during one of the expeditions. The game is an easy platinum though. You just gotta beat the story, do a little bit of miscellaneous stuff. You can use cheats for the PS4 version, but not the PS5 for some reason. But I got this one legit though, the PS4 and PS5. 8 out of 10 game, nowhere near as good as the original. This game comes free, I believe, installed on the PS5. That helps show you the new mechanics and functions of the PS5 and its controller, and the history of PlayStation. There's also so many references to PlayStation exclusive games, it's insane. God of War, Until Dawn, Horizon Zero Dawn, Solid Snake, like Last of Us, Uncharted, Crash Bandicoot, Ratchet & Clank, Final Fantasy, Days Gone, Concrete Genie. I can't think of all of them, honestly. It's insane. The game is very fun, and the music is catchy. But even though I sadly can't show some of the music without paying or downloading from a sketchy website. There's no story of the game. You just go through all four worlds and learn the new things that's up with the PS5. It's very easy to platinum. I'll be surprised to find someone that doesn't have this game as their first PS5 platinum. Besides an auto-pop one, or something like that, or like an easy plat. I recommend trying it out if you somehow already have it. If you want to hear my thoughts on the game, just go to my PS4 part that I timestamped below, because I'm not going to talk about the game right now. But, new console, new version of the game, hit trophy list. I just did the cheating way for this platinum again, and you can boo me all you want, but I already platinumed the game. I don't want to work to get a platinum I already have. And ever since this platinum, I've beaten the game 3 times. So I essentially platinum the game 3 times. you want to hear my thoughts on the game, go to my PS4 part that I timestamped down below. I just did the cheating way to get this trophy, but I did do the PS4 version without the cheats, as you'll see if you watched the PS4 discussion I did earlier. And I played through the game twice after I got this platinum, so, you know. If you want to hear my thoughts on the game, go to my PS4 part that's timestamped down below. Most of the trophies auto-popped when I loaded up the game for the first time, the PS5 one. Some I actually had to play a little bit more for the auto-pop, and then re-signing in back in the morning popped the rest of them. This game was part of the PlayStation Plus collection, a collection of games that were free for PS5 owners that already had PlayStation Plus. I heard that this game was phenomenal, so I just had to try it out. It's really scary, one of the best horror games, at least for the PlayStation. I live streamed my first playthrough and reaction to this game, and that's how I found out why so many people love this game. This game is amazing. The way their actions actually have consequences and different dialogue happens if you do certain actions, it's crazy. There's a status bar that shows you and your character's relationship with others and their traits. Like, if you go investigate a noise by yourself, your character will get more courage in new dialogue. Which, like, I've never seen anything return. That never returned to the quarry, which sucks, man, because that was such a good trait. Also, the don't move feature was so cool, where you had to keep your controller still without moving it. Like, in real life. Or, if you don't, though, you'll mess up and you might get a character killed. But the story of the game, though, is that this game follows 8 teams traveling to a ski lodge on a mountain 1 year after 2 of their friends disappeared. Then they get stranded and they must survive until dawn, with a psycho and a mythical creature hunting them down. It's amazing. The plan is easy, medium. You just gotta beat the game where everyone lives. Then you gotta do a playthrough where everyone dies, grab some collectibles, do a little bit of miscellaneous stuff. 10 out of 10 game, I very much recommend it, and I can't wait to play it again in the future. This game came out in June 2021, and I just had to play it. Me and my grandma played the OG Ratchet & Clank games when I was 7 to 8 years old, so I have nostalgia for this franchise. And I just had to get the newest edition for the franchise that was on the PS5. It was like one of the main reasons I got the PS5. Sure, it was good to get an update, but I wanted to play the new Ratchet & Clank game. I even brought my PS5 into my grandma's room, and we beat the story together. Just like old times. She kind of lost the hang of it on how to play, but she still wanted to watch me play and finish the game. And I'm so glad that we were able to play another Ratchet & Clank game together, just like old times. there's multiple timelines for the Ratchet and Clank games, and I guess this game is a sequel to Into the Nexus, but with the story that Clank repairs an interdimensional device to help Ratchet find other Longbaxes in other dimensions. He gets stolen by Dr. Nefarious, and they get transported into a new dimension with another Longbax named Rivet. And Dr. Nefarious is now the emperor of this place. They work together to try to take both of them down. Game's pretty good. Pretty easy. The platinum is pretty easy. You just gotta beat the story and grab some collectibles and do some miscellaneous trophies. On all the miscellaneous trophies you could do after you beat the game. There's no difficulty related trophies. 10 out of 10 game. I loved returning to this franchise. I played the first Little Nightmares game in 2020, and the universe of the game was so unique and creepy and nasty. It was so cool. I immediately liked it. Like, I'd never seen anything like that before. It was awesome. I'm not here to talk about the first game. This video is about the second game. This game is actually a prequel to the first game. It takes place before it. This one, instead of playing as Six, you play as a little boy named Mono, who was trying to escape a hunter in the woods and make his way through a desolated city. The game is pretty short. I'd say maximum of like 6 hours, maybe 8. It's been a little while since I played, but I know it's a pretty short game. The game is also pretty easy to platinum. You just gotta play through the game once or twice. You just either do a blind playthrough, and then do a second playthrough where you get the rest of the trophies. Or you could just do one playthrough and you follow a guide. I'm not here to judge. You know, that's up to you. 5 out of 10 game though. It's not a game that will stick with me, but it is a game I don't regret playing.